fine.
Joining us now to talk about this and other subjects, in San Francisco, Deborah Saunders, columnist for the San Francisco Chronicle. And with me in Washington, John Aravosis, who blogs at AmericaBlog.com. John Aravosis, have the media gone along with Jim McGreevy's attempt to frame this as just a tragic little love affair where he was overcome by his heart?
I mean, I think the media is going along with considering this as a story at all. I know a lot of us on the left and even the community sort of said, who was he again? I mean, this story happened 2 years ago. No offense to the governor, but, you know, it was New Jersey. It wasn't California. It wasn't New York. He wasn't the president,
right.
You know. And, okay, the guy was gay. He came out. He was married, kind of, But 2 years later, I don't care.
And so why do so many television shows care?
It's a good question. Yeah. I mean, I think to some degree, well, obviously, look, TV likes scandal and controversy, and the guy was married. He was gay, but, this kind of thing. Honestly, I'm a bit... It almost reminds me of like the OJ trial or something.
Right. You're underwhelmed.
I'm underwhelmed.
Deborah Saunders, this guy disgraced the state of New Jersey. Should all these television shows be giving him a platform at all?
Television loves a sinner. They have these designated heroes who, as long as they come before themselves onto the talk shows and bear their sins and say they're sorry, they love them. I have to tell you, in a way, Jim McGreevy was tougher on himself than a lot of those interviewers. Larry King asked him, would you have had to resign if you'd had an affair with a woman? And it was McGreevy himself who had to say, well, yeah, I would have had to resign because I hired somebody who wasn't a U.S. citizen and couldn't get a security clearance to head Homeland Security for my state.
The only person who really conducted an aggressive interview was Sean Hannity of Fox News. Let's take a look at some of his questioning.
They tell me that they can't believe the worst attack in American history, and you're not thinking about them. Hmm. You're thinking about the guy that you're involved in an affair with, and they feel that is the biggest betrayal. What do you say to those people in New Jersey?
The first thing I say is they're right. I mean, it was a betrayal to put your lover on the payroll.
By the way, Golan Sipple, the ex-boyfriend, disputes this account, says he was a victim of sexual harassment. But it seems to me that Hannity zeroed in on the scandal, which
is not about the affair. Sure, but it's not a big surprise that Sean Hannity and Fox News were the only network to say, hey, we've got a gay scandal, let's exploit it. I mean, that's sort of their MO, but I think the sort of normal networks across the board realized it's an old story, and the guy's kind of goofy, and who cares? You know, I mean...
It's refreshing to see somebody who's a television interviewer who doesn't view Jim McGreevy's wife as old news and baggage that we can just sort of...
Oh, Deborah, it's 2 years old. Some of us. Yeah. Osama bin Laden is current news. Jim McGreevy, the 2-year-old out gay governor of New Jersey. You know, Sean Hannity deciding what's news. Come on, Deborah. For bigger issues.
Well, as I said, I think it was refreshing that somebody decided that the way he treated his wife was bad enough to warrant more than one quick sentence, and then we can move on.
All right, we're going to move on because another former official back in the news who hardly ever left, it seems, Bill Clinton, as we mentioned earlier in the program, rolling out what he calls his global initiative, launching a targeted media blitz, sitting down with Larry King and Jon Stewart and Meredith Vieira, and as we saw earlier, Chris Wallace of Fox News. In the Today Show interview, Vieira asked about a recent front page piece in the New York Times dissecting his marriage and examining whether it will be an issue if Hillary Clinton makes a White House run.
I think that the thing that I think is going to be interesting is whether the American people, after all, with all the problems we've got, really want to see the press basically follow the Republican bloodhounds and do all that sort of stuff again, and whether or not the people that are doing it can escape the same scrutiny they have in the past. It's been a free ride. I think it's a stupid way to spend our time.
John Aravosis, is it realistic for Clinton to say the press shouldn't cover his marriage when his wife may run for president and he could be the first spouse?
Well, it's realistic for him to say it. I don't think it's realistic to expect the press to actually do it just because, you know, in a sense, we've got a paparazzi culture that goes all the way up to the White House. I mean, people want to know about Bill Clinton's marriage, even though it's kind of not relevant in terms of whether Hillary Clinton is credible as a presidential candidate or as president. I mean, I want to know how she does in the war on terror. I don't know how she does in the Clinton bedroom. That's irrelevant.
Deborah Saunders, kind of not relevant? Are the media obsessing on the Clinton marriage? Or this is perfectly understandable given what the country went through in the wake of the Monica Lewinsky affair?
Well, I mean, people want to know something about the personal life of the president. I just find it interesting, that answer, because he's acting as if the New York Times is doing the Republican bloodhounds business. I don't see that. I mean, he sure knows how to feel like a victim, as we saw with the Chris Wallace interview.
Well, Howie, all I got to say is, if your sex life pops up on the cover of the New York Times 10 years after that scandal, there's no scandal anymore, but the New York Times still wants to dissect your sex life, I think one would feel invaded whether you're Bill Clinton or Sean Hannity, for
example. The question is whether or not the New York Times will have plenty of company if indeed there's a Hillary campaign.
Well, they probably will.
Now, John Aravosis, you were one of a group of bloggers who had a lunch with Bill Clinton a couple of weeks ago, and you wrote about it, and you said you felt you had a small glimpse of greatness, and you talked about his beautiful blue eyes. Mm-hmm. Were you in a sort of full swoon mode? And what does Clinton get out of hanging out with bloggers?
I was in a half swoon mode. I've always said I would be in full swoon with Hollywood people, but I've been in D.C. for 20 years, so I only get half swoon with politicians. It was interesting. I mean, for us, or for me at least, I wanted to see what the charm was about. People always talk about Clinton's charm, and honestly, I didn't see it. I didn't see someone not charming, but he was just a very intelligent, smart guy, which, of course, was nice to see in a president.
And why does a former president get out of spending 2 hours with you and a bunch of bloggers?
Well, I'm not sure if he gets anything. You know, I'm just honored that he spent time with Meredith Vieira and me, because I'd love to be with Meredith Vieira. But honestly, I think the president realizes that blogs are a power on both the left and the right. Obviously, we're a little more friendly to him than bloggers on the right. And from what I hear, he just wanted to sit down and finally establish some kind of relationship, because honestly, in politics, having relationships with people makes a difference.
All right. As we mentioned earlier in the program, Bill Clinton, on an interview on Fox News Sunday that aired about an hour and a half ago, just unloaded on host Chris Wallace, who was asking him about his record on terrorism, which prompted a long, impassioned answer in which the former president of eventually attack the host. Let's take a brief look at some of that.
So you did Fox's bidding on the show. You did your nice little hit job on me.
Deborah Saunders, what's wrong with the interviewer asking Bill Clinton about his record on terrorism and going after or not going after Bin Laden when he was in office?
There's nothing wrong with asking that. Let me say, I'm sympathetic to Bill Clinton on the point that he was making, which is people did not see Osama bin Laden coming, and it is wrong to blame him for 9/11, which is the point he made. But the way he handled that, everybody knows that when you're on television, you're asked a question that isn't, an area you don't want to talk about or get into, you give a quick answer and move on. Instead, Clinton just unloads on Chris Wallace as if it's an act of lese majeste for him to ask. And then he keeps mentioning Rupert Murdoch, who had just been to the Clinton Global Initiative. Your boss isn't going to like this. He keeps bringing up Rupert Murdoch. Boy, that was a great example of how not to do an interview. I'm shocked at how poorly he handled it.
Oh, I would say on the contrary, it's refreshing to see a president that actually knows the facts and gives more than a 2-second soundbite. Bill Clinton took an
Read
issue
Richard
like Bill Clinton
Clark's
took
book?
It. Yeah, Deborah, maybe you should. But the point is that Bill Clinton took Bill Clinton took a serious issue of 9/11 and who's to blame and what, where we are and where we need to be. And rather than giving a quick soundbite about stay the course, he gave a long answer about a lot of details that frankly Americans do want to know. What? There's been a lot of talk that Bill Clinton's to blame, and Bill Clinton knocked it out of the ballpark saying,
but he did more than that. He said you're doing Fox's bidding. This is a conservative hit job.
But of course it is.
Why was it a conservative hit job?
This is Fox. There's two points. One, this is Fox News. Let's not pretend that Fox News is the Howie Kurtz Reliable Sources show, Howie. I mean, you may have to say that, but for the rest of us, we know Fox is the Republican network.
But Bill Clinton chose to go on Fox News.
But of course, but first of all, Bill Clinton went on Fox News because they said they wanted to talk about his global initiative where he got leaders around the world to commit to making a difference.
Chris Wallace brought it up, Bill Clinton went back to the subject he said he didn't want to talk about.
Right, because
and
once...
And Rupert Murdoch, by the way, has been at the Clinton Global Initiative. Rupert has been at Hillary Clinton events. To act as though Rupert Murdoch is the Republican guy who's always against him, and I really felt it.
Right,
because
Fox News is never against Clinton.
Your boss wouldn't like this.
Right, but the point is, Deborah and Howie, is that once somebody on the right attacks you, too many Democrats have learned to sit back and go, oh, don't attack me. What Bill Clinton realizes is you've got to knock the response out of the ballpark.
The understanding with all these interviews is that half would be on the Global Initiative, half would be on anything else.
Fair enough.
Why is it an attack? You use the word attack for Chris Wallace to say,
because
what
Chris
about
Wallace
Bin Laden?
Chris Wallace brought a book up at the beginning, this Towers Looming or whatever book, that I've talked to some good defense friends who have read the book who said it's not at all an attack on Clinton. He brought up a book out of nowhere and said, this book attacks you, says 9/11, blah, blah, blah. The point is, he started the interview, I'm sorry, you know, the other point I wanted to make really quick was the context of this September 9/11 movie from Disney ABC. 2 weeks ago, Clinton had to deal with a TV movie that was just flat out wrong, blaming him.
Right.
So in that larger context.
And if he
context,
was on my show, I'd want to ask him about that too. Boy, Bill Clinton still gets everybody excited. But
we love him.
John Aravosis, Deborah Saunders, sorry, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.
From NPR.